Thank you for watching Overcomers here on Turning Point. In appreciation of your viewership, Dr. Jeremiah would like to send you the Warrior's Prayer bookmark, absolutely free. Contact Turning Point today. And now, from the American Airlines Center in Dallas, Texas, here is Dr. David Jeremiah with his message, Joseph, Overcoming Disappointments.
Almost everyone in the world knows Simon Cowell, the television star and celebrity. Now, you may love him or hate him, but he's all over the entertainment platform and is one of today's megastars. He's a very eccentric man who typically sleeps until noon every day, watches an hour of Flintstones cartoons every day. He's a health nut who pops vitamin pills and breathes pure oxygen and at the same time is addicted to nicotine. Simon Cowell has learned some hard lessons in his life, and it seems he learned them pretty well. At the beginning of his career, he dreamed of fame and fortune. He grew up in an English town located near some film studios, and that's where he got his job as a young man. Believe it or not, by his late 20s, he had already made $1 million. But then the economy turned against him, and he encountered a series of devastating setbacks. His business went south, and he lost everything. Writing about that, he said, "Everything came crashing down. I got rid of everything. Losing everything is probably the greatest lesson you will ever learn. I went back to my parents' house and started all over again." And out of that experience, he said he learned a principle that has stayed with him and guided his career. And he put it this way, "I've always believed that every single negative can lead to a positive." Every single negative can lead to a positive. That sounds something like what we read in Romans chapter 8, verse 28, where the scripture says that we know all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. This is the truth that enables you and me as believers to overcome the setbacks of bitter disappointment in our lives. So if even a rakish television celebrity can find a pale, secular imitation of that principle and use it to build a successful career, think of the impact it can have on us who know the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to give you another version of that promise from the story of a man named Joseph, who after years of setbacks and bitter disappointments told his brothers who had betrayed him, "You meant it for evil against me, but God meant it for good." In other words, the great lesson of Joseph's life is that every single negative can lead to a positive. God takes our setbacks and he turns them into comebacks. He takes our disappointments and he turns them into his appointments. And he can even take our misfortunes and turn them into a ministry. That's the grace of God. We understand that. We know that. We believe that. We acknowledge that that's part of our truth. And that's what enables us to overcome the setback of disappointment. Some of you here tonight might be downcast at this particular time. Maybe you came here tonight hoping that something would be said that would make your disappointment not hurt so badly. Maybe your girlfriend or your boyfriend dumped you this week. Maybe you lost your job or you missed your promotion that you thought you would have by this time. Maybe you didn't get into the college or university you wanted. Maybe an investment went downhill or a loved one has made a hurtful choice that's broken your heart. Maybe there's been a medical treatment that failed to relieve your illness or disease. Life is full of setbacks. Life is full of delays and disappointments, but the life of Joseph, who we have before us tonight, teaches us how God can turn every negative into a positive. Based on the life of Joseph, I want to give you 6 principles for overcoming in the midst of difficulty. And I'm going to give you the principles that come from his life and then tell you the story that teaches those principles. First thing we have to learn if we're going to be overcomers is that we have to be resourceful in our dreams. Do you know that I believe the Lord gives every child of God a dream, a set of gifts, a set of goals to follow? These unfold as we follow him step by step. And when we commit our lives to Jesus Christ, somewhere within us, a fire is kindled for what God wants us to do in life. I believe that with all my heart. For Joseph, this happened when he was a teenager, growing up in a dysfunctional home full of problems. The story begins in the 37th chapter in the 5th verse where we read these words. Now Joseph had a dream, and he told it to his brothers, and they hated him even more. So he said to them, now listen to this dream. Please hear this dream which I have dreamed. There we were, binding sheaves in the field, and behold, my sheaf arose and also stood upright, and indeed your sheaves stood all around and bowed down to my sheaf. And his brothers said to him, shall you indeed reign over us? Or shall you indeed have dominion over us? So they hated him evermore for his dreams and for his words. Now he should have left his dreams alone after that first one, but he had another one. And he dreamed still another dream. And he told it to his brothers, and he said, look, I have dreamed another dream. I bet that really made their day when he said that. And this time the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars bowed down to me. So he told it to his father and his brothers, and his father rebuked him and said to him, shall your mother and I and your brothers indeed come to bow down to the earth before you? And his brothers envied him, but his father kept the matter in mind. Now you know that in this generation of our faith, we do not get messages from God in dreams. If you're hearing from God in dreams, you're eating too much pizza before you go to bed. God does not communicate today through dreams. We have the finished word of God, and there's no additions to that, even in the dream world. But in another sense, when we give ourselves to Christ and we're truly dedicated to him, he begins to faithfully unfold a plan for us. I am testimony to that. Joseph had an inkling one day, as a teenage boy, that he would be in a place of authority where he could make a difference in his world. And as we're going to see, he encountered tremendous setbacks and disappointments, but he was resourceful in keeping his vision alive. Now, I know theologically a lot of people argue about the nature of these dreams, and they say, Joseph should never have dreamed those dreams. Those were not of God. But here's what I want you to remember. They all came true. They all came true. Joseph's dream was a picture of what would happen to him and his family at the very end of his life. Joseph's dreams may not seem like they're very nice dreams to us, but they're the dream that God put in his heart, and he saw it through to its fulfillment. Secondly, we learn from Joseph to be resilient in our difficulties. When we believe that God has a plan for your life, it helps you when you go through tough times. I remember as a young man, after God called me to preach, my father, who was a pastor, he sat me down and he said, David, make sure that you are called to this ministry. And I tried to quiz him about that. He said, because if you do not know for sure that this is what God has called you to do, when the difficult times come, you will want to quit and walk away. I had no idea how prophetic that was. There have been times in my life early on in my journey in San Diego when I literally stood outside one night and looked up into the heavens and said, God, please get me out of here. I don't want to be here. But he never allowed me to forget that he had called me to that place and called me to that ministry and called me to that task. And it was the resilience in my heart from the calling of God that helped me stay true to my cause when difficult things happened. If you don't know for sure that you have a dream from God, when the difficulties come, you'll waffle, you'll walk. You won't do what God wants you to do. As I mentioned, Joseph's family life was very dysfunctional. Let me tell you what happened to him. According to the record, his older brothers were away shepherding the flocks that belonged to the family of Jacob. Joseph was at home with his father, as some people say, running around in his coat of many colors. And one day, Joseph's father came to him and said, "Joseph, I want you to go find how your brothers are doing. Go check up on them and see how we're doing as they migrate from pasture to pasture caring for our flocks." And so Joseph took off to go check on his brothers, and we pick up the story in the 37th chapter and verse 18. Now, when his brothers saw him from afar off, even before he came near them, they conspired against him to kill him. And they said to one another, "Look, this dreamer is coming. Therefore, let's kill him and cast him into some pit, and we'll just tell our dad some wild beast devoured him, and we'll see what becomes of his dreams then." Joseph's brothers ended up stripping him of his coat of many colors, throwing him into a pit, finally selling him to a passing caravan of slave traders who took him to Egypt and sold him into slavery, where he ended up in the house of Potiphar. It's hard to imagine that this young man, who we believe at this time was 17 years old, how he endured what went on in his life. He was torn from his father, he was betrayed by his brothers, he was stripped of his clothing, he was sold as a slave, he was bound in fetters and irons and marched across the hot sands of the desert to a foreign land where he was auctioned off in the slave trade market of Egypt. So much for his dream. Can you keep your dream alive when the times of difficulty come? But there are two things written about Joseph in this particular moment in his life that we cannot miss, because they're the key to our resiliency in times of difficulty. Two things are written about him. First, he was resilient. Listen to these words from the 39th chapter of Genesis. "Now Joseph had been taken down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him down there. And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man." Keep reading. "And he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian, and his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all he did to prosper in his hand." It's the only place in all of the Bible where the words "successful" and "prosper" occur in the same text. Now get this. Where is Joseph when this happens? He is a slave. He has been taken out of his normal routine. He's not living his dream. His dream is on hold. He had nothing to do with it, but they came and they took him and they put him into slavery. And the Bible says that in the time of slavery, Joseph was a successful man and he was a prosperous man. Because you see, your circumstances don't create who you are. Your circumstances don't define you as a person. Joseph ends up in Potiphar's house as a slave. And if you read the story carefully, it says that while he's in Potiphar's house, Potiphar turns over his whole house to him. He says, "Joseph, take over, run my house for me. And I don't even need to know what's going on. Just run it." As we're going to learn, Joseph has a little time in prison. He gets into prison. You know what happens to him? After he's been in there for a few days, the head prison guy comes to him and he says, "Hey, Joseph, why don't you run the prison for me?" So now Joseph's running the prison. And then he gets out of prison and he ends up back in the palace in Egypt. And the next thing you know, Pharaoh is saying, "Hey, Joseph, why don't you run the whole country?" Everywhere he went, like cream, he came to the top, because it wasn't about his circumstances. It was about his heart. It was about his walk with God. It was about his person. It was about his character. It was about who he was. We have to stop blaming our circumstances for everything that goes wrong in life. And then notice, did you notice what it said about Joseph when he was in this terrible situation? Twice it says that the Lord was with him. Do you know that God goes with us wherever we go? Not just to the good places and the easy places. God goes with us. We're going to learn in a few moments, God goes to prison. God does some of his best work in prison. He has a captive audience. Resilience is the capacity to pick yourself up, patch yourself up, get back on the horse. It's the quality of bouncing back, of never giving in or giving up. For the child of God, resiliency isn't a matter of self-sufficiency, it's a matter of God's sufficiency. It's based on his very presence in our lives. The Bible says that God was with Joseph. How many of you know if you got God with you, wherever you are, you're going to be okay. You're going to win. You're going to be on the right side. And here's what I want you to know. God has promised to be with us. This isn't just an Old Testament story buried in the history of the annals of the book of Genesis. This is a testimony to what God wants to do for you and me. I love what Isaiah said about this. He said, "Now thus says the Lord who created you, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Fear not, for I'm with you." I claim that promise as my own. I do not walk into the unknown future of my life by myself. God is with me. So if you're going to be an overcomer, Joseph teaches you, first of all, be resourceful in your dreams and be resilient in your difficulties. And now we come to kind of the centerpiece of this story, and the principle here is be resistant in your desires. There's a little phrase at the end of the 39th chapter, verse 6, that gives us an idea as to Joseph's physical appearance. Now, Joseph was handsome in form and appearance, which being translated into vernacular of the day is he was well-built and good-looking. Joseph was a man who made women turn their heads. And the Bible tells us that his master's wife, Potiphar's wife, took notice of him and tried to seduce him. Chapter 39, verse 7 says, "And it came to pass after these things that Joseph's master's wife cast longing eyes on Joseph and said, 'Lie with me.' But he refused and said to his master's wife, 'Look, my master does not know what is with me in the house, and he has committed all that he has to my hand. And there is no one greater in this house than I, nor has he kept back anything from me but you, and you're his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?' So it was as she spoke to Joseph day after day that he did not heed her to lie with her. But it happened about this time, when Joseph went into the house to do his work, and none of the men of the house was inside, that she caught him by the garment, saying, 'Lie with me.' But he left his garment in her hand and fled and ran outside." That's in the Bible. That's in the Bible. And it's an illustration of the fact that there are some things the Bible tells us we are never to fight. Did you know that the Bible tells us that we're to flee immorality? We're to run away from it. I've told kids ever since I've been teaching this passage to young people that the best equipment you can ever get for overcoming sexual temptation is the best pair of Adidas money will buy. Here was a woman physically infatuated with her husband's handsome, strapping young slave, and she did everything she could to lure him into immorality. But Joseph knew two things. He knew that if he slept with Potiphar's wife, it would betray the man who had invested a great deal of confidence in him. And even greater, it would be a sin against his God. And he resisted and he refused. And when she tried to physically force him into bed, he ran out of the house, leaving his coat in her hands, because Joseph knew that he was better off without his coat than without his character. And today, all these years later, men and women, which is evident by what we seem to see on television almost every day, we face the very intensity of temptation that Joseph faced. But here's the promise we have in the New Testament. No temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond that you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. I hear people say all the time, you know, the temptation is just so great, Pastor, I just don't know what to do. Well, the Bible tells you that if you follow God, he will give you the way out, and you don't have to yield to that temptation. If we're going to be overcomers, we have to be resourceful in our dreams, resilient in our difficulties, resistant in our desires. Notice the fourth one, we have to be resolute in our disappointments. Here's the next chapter in Joseph's life. Watch this. When Joseph refused the seduction of his boss's wife, she went to her husband and accused Joseph of sexual assault. He hadn't done anything. He was innocent, but he ended up in prison. And even there, the Bible says, the Lord was with him. I love this passage. Then Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, a place where the king's prisoners were confined. And he was there in prison. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison committed to Joseph's hand all the prisoners who were in the prison. Whatever they did there, it was his doing. And the keeper of the prison did not look into anything that was under Joseph's authority, because the Lord was with him, and whatever he did, the Lord made it prosper. I mean, I don't know that I have any aspirations to be successful in prison, but Joseph was successful in prison. And listen to me now. Joseph is now age 28. He's been in prison since he was 17. He's now 28. That's 11 years. And when he was 28, one day he heard that two new prisoners had arrived at the jailhouse. They were royal prisoners. One of them was the king's baker, and the other was the king's butler. And their story is told in chapter 40. Now, once again, both of these men dream dreams one night, and they come down for breakfast the next day, and they're very troubled because they know they have dreamed dreams that are important, but they don't know what they mean. Someone told them that Joseph had a skill set that would help him deal with their dreams. And so they go to Joseph and he tells them their dreams. Without taking time for the details, I'll give you the bottom line. Joseph told the butler that within 3 days he would be restored to his position in the palace. The news wasn't very good for the baker. Now here's exactly what the scripture says. Within 3 days, Pharaoh will lift off your head from you and hang you on a tree, and the birds will eat your flesh from you. I bet he wished he hadn't asked for that dream to be interpreted. And that's exactly what happened. Joseph made a request to the butler, and he asked him, when he returned to the palace, he said, look, you're going back to work, you're going back to the palace, just do me a favor when you get back there and you get a chance to speak to Pharaoh. Tell Pharaoh that I'm here. I don't deserve to be here. I've been here for 11 years. I don't want to spend the rest of my life in this prison. Would you put in a good word for me with the king? Now, let me give you the report on that. It's interesting because part of it's in the end of the 40th chapter and the other part's in the first verse of chapter 41. You kind of have to read scriptures like that once in a while, put the chapters together. Here's what it says. Yet the chief butler did not remember Joseph, but forgot him. And it came to pass at the end of 2 full years that Pharaoh had a dream. This guy went back to the palace, promising he was going to tell the king about Joseph, and the scripture says 2 years went by and nothing happened. I mean, we all know what disappointment feels like. It's like a sucker punch in the stomach. We feel a strong desire for things to happen, and we have a dream, and we have an aspiration, and we have a goal, and suddenly it evaporates right before our eyes. We're cut from the team. We don't get the job. Our book isn't published. Our album flops. Our proposal is rejected. Our candidate loses. Our trip is canceled. Our insurance company rejects our claim, and we miss the shot, and we lose the game. Anytime we have a desire or a dream or an aspiration, we're setting ourselves up for disappointment. And I can only imagine, friends, how Joseph felt when day after day passed and no word came from the butler or the palace or the king. He had been in bondage from age 17 to now nearly 30, and his one big break, his one and only hope, never materialized. He must have felt like giving up and resigning himself to live out his days behind bars and die in prison. But Joseph didn't give up. He never lost hope. He never went back on his dream, because Joseph understood something I have learned to understand. God's delays are never God's denials. He may delay, but he doesn't always deny. The Lord had a perfect calendar laid out for Joseph in advance, and there wasn't a wasted day anywhere in its pages. Everything was unfolding perfectly according to God's timetable, and Joseph just hung in there even when he didn't know what was going on. He knew the God that he loved and served, and God was with him. And you know the rest of the story, but I can't leave you hanging. I got to tell you the whole thing. The fifth principle is to be responsible in your duties. Watch what happens. One day, the king woke up, and he'd had a set of dreams the night before that troubled him greatly. And who should be there to listen to him talk about his dreams than the guy that Joseph sent back to the palace? The king starts to talk about his dreams and how they trouble him, and the butler says, "Hey, I know somebody can help you with that. I just remembered." All of a sudden, after 2 years, he had a memory loss, and now he's back. And he says, "Let me go get Joseph." And Pharaoh brings Joseph in, and he describes his dreams to Joseph, and the Lord gave Joseph the insight to interpret them. And you know the story. It was a prediction of 7 years of abundant crops followed by 7 years of terrible famine. And Joseph told the king to make diligent plans to store vast amounts of grain for the next 7 years to withstand the ensuing years of famine. And he suggested the king select a capable leader to oversee the program. Verse 37. So the advice was good in the eyes of Pharaoh and in the eyes of all of his servants. And Pharaoh said to his servants, "Can we find such a one as this? I mean, a man in whom is the Spirit of God?" And Pharaoh said to Joseph, "Inasmuch as God has shown you all of this, there is no one as discerning and wise as you. You shall be over my house and over my people. You shall rule according to your word. Only in regard to the throne will I be greater than you." Once again, Joseph moved up the ladder, and he got the top job. Verse 46 says, Joseph was 30 years old when he stood before Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and Joseph went out from the presence of Pharaoh and went throughout the land of Egypt. How old was he when he was sold into slavery? 17. How old was it when it got all resolved? 30. Longest 13 years of Joseph's life. The last years of his teens, the entire decade of his 20s, had been spent in slavery or prison, but nothing was lost. Nothing was wasted. All the hardship, all the disappointment, all the delays, it was all preparing Joseph to literally overnight become the second most powerful man in the world, in effect, the prime minister and governor of Egypt. Is that a story or what? But it's still not over. We have to learn to be restrained in our determinations. This is the most meaningful epic in the life of Joseph. I have to honestly tell you, I've read this story many times and preached on it two or three. I hardly ever get through it without tears. It is one of the most emotional stories in the Bible. While all this is going on with Joseph, a famine comes. And it's a terrible famine, and there's no food anywhere. But the word is out that there's some dude down in Egypt who'd been saving food for 7 years. So Jacob gets his boys together and he says, hey, I hear they got a lot of food down in Egypt and they've kind of saved it up, and you need to go down there and see if you can get some food or we're going to starve. So Joseph's brothers come to Egypt and they have no idea that Joseph is there or who he is or what he's doing, and they have no idea that they're going to meet their long lost brother. And when they get there, I have to tell you, I love this because Joseph has got to be, he's got to be my kind of man. He plays with his brothers. He plays with them. After all he's been through, he has the right to play with them. Verse 7, where do you come from? And they said, from the land of Canaan to buy food. So Joseph recognized his brothers, but they did not recognize him. First thing he did is he threw him in prison for 3 days. Cool him off a little bit. And then he brought them back and told them he would provide grain for their family on one condition. He said, one of the brothers has to stay under arrest in Egypt. And Joseph closed his mouth and listened to what they would say. So Joseph's in this room. Now, you got to get this picture and get it right. These brothers are in this room, and they have no idea that Joseph understands Hebrew. So they don't think Joseph understands what they're saying. So he's in the room, and here's the conversation they have when Joseph is listening and they don't think he knows what they're saying. Then they said to one another, we are truly guilty concerning our brother, for we saw the anguish of his soul when he pleaded with us, and we would not hear. Therefore, this distress has come upon us. And Reuben answered them, saying, I told you, don't sin against the boy, and you wouldn't listen. Therefore, behold, his blood is now required of us. But they did not know that Joseph understood them, for he spoke to them through an interpreter, and he turned himself away from them and wept. I can see Joseph in my mind's eye, listening, his heart torn within him, remembering the anguish that came because of what happened to him at the hand of his own brothers. And he finds a quiet corner in the palace, and he covers his face with his hands, and he sobs, and all the pain of all those years come out of his life. And the story that follows twists and turns as Joseph orchestrates a series of events. He brings the brothers back to Egypt, and he sends them back and brings them back distress and more trouble. And I'll tell you one of the things he did that was really cool. If you read the story, you'll read it. One time they came back, and he set them up for a meal, and he put place cards around the table in the order of their birth. Now, they walk in there, and I'm telling you what, that freaked them out. How could anybody know? Because when you're grown, you can't tell how old a person is. I told you he was playing with them. Here's the details of what happened, the most poignant part of the story. Joseph could not restrain himself before all those who stood by him, and he cried out, make everyone go out from me. So no one stood with him while Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept aloud, and the Egyptians in the house of Pharaoh heard it. And Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. Does my father still live? And his brothers couldn't answer him, for they were dismayed in his presence. And Joseph said to his brothers, please come near to me. And they came near. And he said, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt. But now do not therefore be grieved or angry with yourselves. Listen to this. Because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve your life. For these 2 years the famine has been in the land, and there are still 5 years which will be neither plowing nor harvesting. And God sent me before you to preserve a posterity for you in the earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So now it was not you who sent me here, but God, and he has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all of his house and a ruler throughout the land of Egypt. Hurry, go up to my father and say to him, thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not tarry. You shall dwell in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near to me, you and your children, your children's children, your flocks and your herds and all that you have, and I will provide for you. And he kissed all of his brothers and wept over them. And after that, his brothers talked with him. What a moment that must have been. Joseph, over all the years of his suffering and difficulty, had learned how to forgive, how to release the accumulated bitterness of the years, how to reconcile with those who had wronged him, how to treat his brothers with respect they didn't deserve. And the brothers went back to Judah, and the end of the story is like this. They loaded up their aged father, and they returned to Egypt, and the family was reunited in unity and prosperity. And a little bit later, Jacob, the father, died. Now the brothers were afraid again. They were afraid that with the old man out of the picture, Joseph might seek revenge against them. But in the last chapter of Genesis, Joseph made one of the greatest statements of compassion you will find anywhere in the Bible. Here's what he said. Do not be afraid, for am I in the place of God? But as for you, you meant all of this for evil against me. But God meant it for good, in order to bring it about this day to save many people alive. Therefore, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. There cannot be a better short story in captivity. An incredible story. And Joseph saw what God wants us to see, that even while we often don't understand what God is up to, God is up to something. He's at work. And sometimes the things that don't make sense to us, we look back later, even in this life, and we can see. And sometimes we say, oh, so that's what you were up to. All through this time, God never lost control of the situation. He was moving people around like a chessboard, making sure everything was just right so that at the right time, in the right place, the resolution that we just read could happen. I read this story and I look at all of you and I wonder, are there some people you need to forgive? I know a lot of abuse occurs in our world. We don't want to excuse behavior of others and not let them bear responsibility for their actions. But we also don't want to harbor bitterness in our hearts. And there comes a time to let forgiveness, the forgiveness of Jesus Christ, wash over us and our situations in life. Recently, there was a book written that talked about the fact that the Old Testament is not as viable as the New Testament in terms of its integrity and message, and that perhaps we would be better off if we disconnected Jesus Christ from the Old Testament. But I want to tell you something, you can't do that, because right here in this story, you will see Jesus. Do you know that Jesus is the Joseph of the New Testament, and Joseph is the Jesus of the Old? Listen to me. He was a dearly loved son of his father, clothed with regal garments. He was rejected by his brothers. He was stripped and abused, sold for pieces of silver, bound and condemned unjustly, who was tempted but did not sin, and about whom nothing bad was ever proven. Yet despite his flawless character, he became a servant. He served faithfully, yet was convicted. On one occasion, he found himself between two criminals, one of whom was lost and the other who was saved. At the age of 30, this man, too, entered into his life's great work of saving the world. And he uttered the words, "Do not be afraid." And he knew how to forgive in a way that is almost unimaginable. His story is one of ultimate reconciliation. Joseph forgave his brothers, but Jesus forgives anyone who asks him. And the example of Joseph, I want to tell you, men and women, the example of Joseph fires me with the fuel of staying after what God's called me to do and being an overcomer no matter what happens. But someone greater than Joseph is available to us today. Joseph is an historic figure. But sometimes we go through years of disappointment and delays and bitter setbacks, and some of you are struggling with that right now. Let me tell you that the Lord Jesus Christ is not a figure of history. He is the present Lord God in this world. He's as close to you as your next breath, and he keeps us resilient in our calamities. And by his grace, we can be forgiven for whatever we have done, and be restored to fellowship with him, and therefore prepared to make other relationships that have gone bad in our lives right. It starts with Jesus. It starts with making life right with God through his Son, Jesus Christ. And when we do that, God gives us the power to forgive others who have hurt us. Maybe you came here tonight discouraged, feeling like life is going to be the same from now on because you don't know what to do. I hope that you will see that tonight is God's movement in your life to bring you to a place of reconciliation. First of all, with God Himself, and secondly, with those in your life who you need to forgive. I've often felt like our forgiveness of other people comes from the reservoir of God's forgiveness of us. If God can forgive me of all that I have done to unfaithfully honor Him so many times in my life in the past, if God can forgive me of all of that, is there anything I can't forgive that someone else might do to me? Let this be a night of forgiveness. Forgiveness from God for your sin. Forgiveness of others who have hurt you. Let Joseph's life speak into your life and be an overcomer from this moment on.
This month on Turning Point, Dr. Jeremiah would like to offer you, in moments like these, a new 365-day devotional for 2019, yours for a gift of any amount in support of this program. Or, when you support this ministry with a gift of $120 or more, you will receive 4 copies of In Moments Like These so that you can share with others. And, if you enjoyed today's message, you can also request Dr. Jeremiah's latest book, Overcomer, or his comprehensive Overcomer study set. Your support will help this program continue on this station and keep the ministry on firm financial footing going into the new year. Contact Turning Point today.
If you personally have never taken the step to believe in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you can do that today. And if you will allow us, Dr. Jeremiah would like to send you 2 resources that will help you. The first is a booklet called Your Greatest Turning Point, which will help you as you begin your relationship with Christ. And the second is our monthly devotional magazine, Turning Points, to give you encouragement and inspiration throughout the year. These resources are yours completely free when you contact Turning Point today.
Next time on Turning Point.
Almighty God wants to have a relationship with you. He knows you better than you know yourself. He has loved you before the foundation of the world. He wants to know you. He wants to be walking with you. He wants you to walk with Him. And the only thing that keeps you from God is your own unwillingness to accept His plan, which is salvation through His Son, Jesus Christ.
Thank you for being with us today. Join Dr. Jeremiah next time for another Overcomer's message. Moses, overcoming tremendous obstacles. Here on Turning Point.